I'm Barbara Karpuzian, and you are watching the Everlasting Love Program. Musician, songwriter, pastor, and speaker can best describe our guest today. He will share his journey from a young rock and roll blues musician to a transformed servant of God who uses his gifts and talents and music for over 30 years to share God's love and to educate others in the music business. Stay tuned to hear his story.
Crossroad, fell down on my knees. I went down to the crossroad, fell down on my knees. Lord above for mercy, save me if you please. Well, I went down to the crossroad, tried to flag it right.
Welcome back to the program. You were watching the Glenn Kaiser Band, and I hope that you enjoyed that. And if you did, you are going to love the rest of this program. You're watching Everlasting Love, and we want you to know that God loves you with an everlasting love. It doesn't matter what your experiences have been in life. It doesn't matter how deep of a pit you might feel that you're in right now, or what has happened to you, or things that maybe you have done. God wants you to know that He is reaching out for you today. He loves you. He cares about you. He wants you to get to know Him. He wants to develop a relationship with you. And that's why He says, I love you with an everlasting love. During the course of the program, you will see a phone number flash up on the screen. You'll also see our website, 773-286-2172, www.secretplacecog.com. We would love to hear from you. If you have a comment about something that you saw today, if you have a prayer request, if you're looking for a good church or a Bible study, if you want to know more about our guest, please call us, leave us a message, or drop us an email, and we will get back to you. I'm always excited to do these programs because it gives me an opportunity to present various individuals to you, our listening audience, and for you to experience the richness of the guests that are on our program. And today's guest is one of those. He is known as the grandfather of Christian rock. And maybe he doesn't like the idea that I'm calling him the grandfather of Christian rock, but this is something that he's been doing from a very young age, probably since like 8 or 9 years old. And you had a chance to get a glimpse of him at the beginning of the program, but I'm going to introduce him now. With us on the program is Glenn Kaiser. And Glenn, anybody that's watching today who knows anything about music knows your name. And I know that because as I was talking to various individuals that I've interacted with this past week, they're like, yeah, Glenn Kaiser, he's the granddaddy of Christian rock.
Well, I am a grandfather, so there you go.
There you go. You know, and we're so glad that you decided to come on. I know you have a really busy schedule. As a matter of fact, you said that you just came back from a 5-day tour
up in Ontario. Yeah, we were actually 2 weeks ago, we were in Vancouver, BC, actually Chilliwack, about an hour from Vancouver, at Back to Blues Festival, and did a show, actually led worship the next morning, flew back, we're home for 2 days, and drove up to Belleville, Ontario, which is about 14 hours. And then we were in Belleville and Kitchener and, oh gosh, Sarnia. I think I'm forgetting somewhere. But anyway, we did a bunch of concerts, and it was fun. People were very receptive. Mm-hmm. And as always, really good conversations with people after the night mm-hmm. is over. We go out and hang out with people and talk
to them. How long have you been doing this?
Well, I'm 53. I started Res Band at 18. And I didn't grow up as a Christian or in the church or anything. So I actually started playing guitar when I was about 12. And the first band happened to be called The Lost Souls, and I think that that name's been used by a few bands, as a matter of fact. But
and you weren't a Christian at the time.
No way, and
sort of prophetic, isn't it?
Well, we were lost for sure, and so 13, yeah, when that happened, and played in bands right up until just before I started to follow the Lord, and you know, Jesus made Himself very plain to me on a number of levels, and it was just before my 18th birthday that I surrendered to Him. And
why don't you go back and take us through that journey.
Well, I mean, a number of things for people maybe to know. I grew up in central Wisconsin. I didn't grow up in inner city Chicago where I live now. I was born in Beaver Dam, which is a town of about, at that time, 12,000 people. I think it's about 15,000 there now. And south central Wisconsin, farming community. My dad made a lot of money in Chicago, and then in Milwaukee, met my mother. He'd been driving truck. He was a terminal manager for a large trucking company, and they offered him a better job and than that, making more bucks, and he wanted to be around his family more, so he said no, quit. Started his own business. About a year later, partner ran off with all the cash in the safe and never saw him again. Within another year or so, he had a series of operations on the base of his spine, and we lost everything, and moved from house to house, and a lot of hunting and fishing where I come from, but we did it to eat mm-hmm. and to live. My mother started committing adultery on my dad. Mm-hmm. She went to the city, Milwaukee, to try to pay bills, got a good job down there, came back on the weekends. Our family basically fell apart. I was the youngest of three kids.
And this happened when you were about how old?
Well, they divorced when I was 9, okay. But things caved in from the time I was about 6 or 7.
Okay.
And just frayed. You know, my sister was out with her girlfriends and eventually boyfriends, and my brother was doing the same, hanging out with his buddies. And
you know, I kind of raised myself, which nobody raises themselves, you know. Mm-hmm. So moved to the city at, when I was 9 to Milwaukee with my mom, and she divorced my dad. And I suppose at that point in time, I started getting into sexual addictions. Let's just say that the neighbors were all involved in incest, and I got involved with some of the, one of their sisters or two of their sisters, and you know, it's just a mess. You know, it's just mm-hmm. a mess when you're trying to find love.
Yes.
And what you're finding is sex, which doesn't necessarily mean you're finding love. You know, my wife Wendy has a whole askwendy.com, mm-hmm. yeah, with Wendy with an I, and she does a whole thing on dating and sex and relationships, web pages, and teaches on it and stuff.
Ask and Wendy with an I, WENDI.com, yeah, right? Because I saw that website. Yeah. Lots of great stuff.
She's amazing. There. Well, she went through a different set of situations. Like, she grew up in the church. I grew up with no church. But she was abused by her grandfather and went through a whole series of things. I mean, when I was a kid, in my day, these things didn't happen, or if they did, nobody talked about them, nobody knew about them. But I'm thinking that they probably happened more often than we knew. And anyway, so I got very caught up, very addicted, and as time went on, 12 years old, got interested in music, bugged the old lady to get me a guitar and an amp. She did. I started learning mm-hmm. from a friend of mine, just basic chords and mm-hmm. figuring out where the notes were on the neck, and got involved in bands. Mm-hmm. So now it's sex and drugs.
Right.
You know,
it's escalated. But
with the music, you know.
I just want you to, if you could just go back a little bit, when you talked about your parents getting a divorce.
Yeah.
And in a society where 1.5 out of every 2 marriages ends up in divorce, and I see a lot of these children myself, I deal with them. Can you remember what you felt like during that time and articulate that?
Yep, easy, miserable. I think I got along better with my dog than my mother or father. And I didn't understand what was going on. I was too young to really grasp. I could feel that the family was unraveling, but I didn't know, like, I couldn't judge our family on the basis of other families. We didn't connect with anybody hardly. I mean, nobody was ever home. My father was gone most of the time at that point. He was working, you know, a couple hours away, and whatever. I think he just gave up on the family. I think he felt pretty devastated, and he made a wrong choice in not hanging out with his sons and his daughter. Mm-hmm. They were just kids. They were, you know, in their late teens. They just wanted to be out and have fun. There wasn't any mom and dad around to stop them, so they did. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I'd come walking in this little house on the edge of town in the middle of nowhere in the dark, and I was scared to death of the dark. Actually, that's how I started singing. I started singing because I was so spooked out by the darkness. And I'd reach around these little push button lights in this old farmhouse up on a hill. So check this out. I'm walking outside of this little town where we live, Fox Lake, Wisconsin. 1,181, little town, you know. I remember because I passed the sign every day going to school. I walk up, and the last house, just before our house, which is up on this hill, 2 or 3 trees, plowed under cornfield, you know, pitch black. The last street light ended a block away, and I'm freaking out of the dark. The last house I passed before our house, a lady had hung herself, some 80-year-old lady had hung herself, committed suicide, you know, the year before we moved in. That house was empty. So I'm walking past that house, I started singing, you know. I just make up songs, crawl in, turn on the light. I'd come home to an empty house.
Wow.
When Dylan sang in one of his songs back in the 60s, "It's a house, not a home."
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
You could relate to that.
Oh, man. Yeah. When Hendrix said, "There ain't no life nowhere," truest words I ever heard up until I heard the gospel.
Right.
So, I mean, yeah, I felt empty, miserable, angry, betrayed. Mm-hmm. I didn't know what love meant. I didn't understand commitment. I didn't, very confusing. So, for me, sex and music, and then eventually drugs, because a lot of my musician buddies were smoking dope and you know, I read all this stuff, AMA reports.
Sure.
So I came in the other direction. Sure. I read all this stuff. I knew what was going to happen to me if I did dope, but I started doing it because why not?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, why not? I might as well have a little pleasure in life kind of thing.
Sure.
That's
sure.
where I was at.
Well, and if you don't understand what your destiny is, if you don't know what your identity is as a human being, then right, it just all sort of seems futile.
I mean, we evolved from a mud pack.
Right.
We have no purpose.
Mm-hmm.
I don't even know if we have value. I mean, when you talk about divorce and abortion, well, then what's family? What does that mean?
Right.
And why?
Sure.
Why? What's the point? And and so at that point, I thought, well, okay, I'm worthless. Life is worthless. Get a little bit on the way out, I guess, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I figured I'd probably just OD, and I did three times. I tried to kill myself. I went through... Between the time I was 16 and 18, I did everything but run needles, everything but shooting heroin. I mean, I was very close to shooting smack when I came to the Lord, and also very close to being an alcoholic. I really had it down, you know, how to pop the malt liquor. And, there's a friend of mine who's been coming to Cornerstone Festival, which is one of the things we have an inner city church called Jesus People USA, and we do a lot of stuff in the inner city of Chicago. But one of the things we've done since in 1984 is this really huge music and teaching and arts festival called Cornerstone. Well, this guy was coming for years with his son, and never once did he come up out of the crowd and say, I'm here, you know. His name was Butch. Butch was in a band with me and my cousin. Called Misery's Sons. I'm not kidding you. I don't know where these names... I didn't name the band, but I completely relate. And we were doing blues and rock and jam band stuff back in the late 60s, early 70s, before I became a Christian. One night, there was a dope party, and there were so many... back in the freak days, hippie days, everybody was so fried. It's in Milwaukee, right close to UWM campus. I mean, smoke was rolling out the door. I remember throwing up and seeing four of everything. I was so loaded. I'd been drinking and smoking dope and smoking hash and dropping acid and just all day. Finally, the last thing I remember is I was in the bathtub because a cop had come to the door and said we need to turn the noise down. I mean, I don't know why he didn't just bust us. There was more dope rolling out that door. I mean, there's no way he couldn't smell it. And everybody kind of went, uh-oh, there's a cop, you know, walked into the bathroom. I'm like in the bathtub with four or five people I don't know, or just shut the curtain. You know, you're not going to get away from the cops.
Sounds,
I mean, what are you doing?
Sounds real surreal,
you know? Hello? We were all so loaded. That's one of the last things I remember. Well, the next thing I knew, like, I'm seeing this little white dot like this, just about that fast. I'm like, whoa, what's that? And turned out that... It was a street light. It finally kind of slowed down and quit. And it was a window in a bedroom with the street light shining in. It was pitch black. And I was like 35 miles from Milwaukee at one of the houses where we used to practice as a band. Well, this guy who's been coming to Cornerstone Festival years later, Butch, was playing rhythm guitar in the band. And they found me on the front lawn, you know, with an empty wine bottle in one hand and a joint in the other, and you know, vomit all over me, and, you know, they hauled me into a Volkswagen, took me up there, it's 35 miles north of Milwaukee, and basically tossed me in bed with my clothes on and everything. They looked at me, and I wasn't hardly breathing, and they thought I had died, and they were all so loaded, I don't think they knew what planet they were on. They freaked. They go, what are we going to do? We got a corpse, you know, he's dead. They left. They didn't know what to do. They just left. So I wake up at about 4:30 or 5 in the morning. I have no idea where I am or how I got there, you know. If the cops would have said, Barbara, you murdered six people last night, and we got witnesses.
You'd agree to it, or?
I don't know. I would have had no idea whether I did or didn't. I mean, there are chunks of time in those years, 16, 17, 18. I mean, I really don't have... Well, more like 15, 16, and 17, because, as I said, just before I turned 18 was when I asked the Lord into my life. But I have no idea what happened. People told me about things that I did that were there. You know, people in bands, girlfriends, whatever. And I don't know. You know,
Yeah, and probably at that age, you're not really, or maybe you are, I don't know how in tune you were with yourself, but you're not really recognizing that all this is going on because there is all this pain, because there is this nobody loves me, there
is care.
This, I'm not, I don't have value.
I didn't care.
You know, at 15, 16, and you look back at it now in retrospect, and it's kind of like, you know,
well,
I
you're
get
killing
it
yourself.
Now.
You're yeah. killing yourself. Yeah. You're destroying yourself. And you kind of know on one level, but on another level, you don't. And all I can say is, you know, we talk about sin as Christians. We say, yeah, sin is fun for a season. Mm-hmm. Well, there's four seasons in a year, you know? And that one season, it didn't last long. Hmm. That means three quarters of the time, you're miserable. You're just not at peace. You're not, there's no point. There seems to, it's senseless. Everything right. is, the life is. Why? I mean, now I talk to people in their city on Wilson Avenue. I talk to people all the time. And you hear their stories. And, you know, I can read the mail. I've been doing this for too many years. I know too many people. I live in a community with a couple hundred adults and a couple hundred kids. I mean, we deal with people all the time. Even just practical insight after doing that for years, you begin to pick up when somebody's shooting you a line or when they're speaking truthfully about what's going on or what's happened in their life, at least from their perspective.
Sure.
A lot of people don't care about paying taxes. Or working a 9-to-5 job, or any of it. They've checked out because they don't see any point.
And it drives the rest of us crazy. We're
why
like,
bother?
Wait, you know?
I'd rather live in the street. I don't even, you know, we do a shelter. We have, what, 380 beds. We do all, you know, we work with all these people. A pile of these people could care less about, they don't want to be in a shelter. They don't want to relate to people that closely. They don't trust people. They feel like, look, people have ripped me off all my life. I can't trust anybody. I've gone through a couple of marriages or whatever. You know what I mean? Several jobs. I've never been happy. Life is senseless. And for some of them, they've even begun to realize I'm as bad as everybody. I mean, I don't have any solution either.
Right.
I you know, would I hang out with me if there were two of me? You know, I don't know. So I get it. I get it in spades. And for me... Yeah.
It's amazing how people could get to such a depraved condition in their lives and just miss out on so much.
You know, the scripture says this. It says, God's word says, without hope and without God in the world. And the truth is, it's none of us are without God in the sense that God is omnipresent. God is everywhere. Whether you feel him, whether you know he's being gracious to you, taking care of you, protecting you from stuff, you have no idea what could have happened had God allowed it or took his hand away from you at any time. I mean, those times when I overdosed, attempted suicide, I went through all this mess before I became a Christian. I didn't know that God was there, and he was there all along.
Sure.
But I'm in this situation, and I'm looking around, and I'm realizing you've done this to yourself. Nobody put a gun to your head. I made these choices. Nobody told me to go, you know, from girl to girl, bed to bed. Nobody told me swap bands, like, you know, your clothing, because you get tired of these people and the sound of music. You go to something else, start a new one. I did that all the time. Nobody forced me to do dope. You know, I made these choices. But I made them because it didn't seem like there was any reason not to. I mean, why? What? Who cares? There's no point. We're all animals dressed up. Let's, you know, eat, drink.
And be
tomorrow,
merry.
Tomorrow we die,
right.
Forget it. What's the point? So I was. I was without hope and without God in the world. And so when we talk to people today, people coming up after concerts, going out and talking, sitting down, chatting with folks, you know, there's so many people. They're so lost, and that is the word.
Yes.
Lost.
Yes.
They don't really have a great deal of hope. They don't have any sense that of their own worth or value. They don't have real respect for God. Therefore, they don't really have much respect for themselves.
Sure.
And they don't know that they can trust anybody else either.
Sure. So you're 18 years old, and you're in this band. And what's happening now?
Well, like I said, I OD'd. I went through all this mess. There was a little piece of time up there in Fox Lake where some gray-haired old ladies came by and somehow induced my parents to let them take me to a vacation Bible school. I would have been six about 6 years old at the time, and it was about six Saturdays for, you know, maybe a couple of hours or something, and they had me memorize John 3:16. Mm. And I remember little pictures of Jesus, you know, cut out pictures, and, you know, we recess and eating paste and, you know, whatever. And that's about it. They had me memorize this John 3, you know, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever would believe in him, which means to trust in him, to cling to him, to rely on him, will not perish but have everlasting mm-hmm. life. Yeah, mm-hmm. It's John 3:16. And I thought, cool, they gave me a little New Testament and Psalms and a little pen that looked like a baseball bat, had a pen in it, you know. And they gave me this New Testament and Psalms, which I promptly took home and gave to my mother, who stuck it in her junk drawer, you know. So here I am, I've gone through all this mess with dope, and I'm hating myself, I can't seem to change, I'm addicted to several things, and I know I'm destroying myself, and I don't know any way to stop, or mm-hmm. I probably don't know if I have any real reason to, mm-hmm. but I hate what's going on, and I'm a mess. One night, after I had a horrible trip, I came down, and I said to my mom, do you still have that old New Testament and Psalms, you know, that I, you know, and she went, what? And I said, do you still have that little Whoa. Bible they gave me as a kid?
Whoa.
And she goes, out of nowhere, I mean, no, Whoa. No church. I mean, she's been living in adultery with a guy, married guy for 18 years. Yeah. I mean, it's just, he's over there several nights a week. I mean, it's just, she's like completely, what? And I said, if you got it, give it to me, please, yeah? So she's like, whoa. So she gets up and pulls the thing out and gives it to me. I go upstairs and I do one of these just wherever. And I'm either reading, what was it? Matthew 24, Mark 13, or Luke 21. All three of those chapters talk about all the signs of the times right before Jesus returns in that generation kind of thing. I read the whole chapter. I don't know which one of those three it was, but it was one of those. And I read it, and I went, whoa. I was like, whoa, shiver time. You know, shut the thing, throw it in my drawer. Forgot about it. A few weeks later, I come home, the chair knocked down. My mom's gone. Black Labrador Sam, who truly was my one and only friend, I guess, he was bouncing around the kitchen. I thought, something's wrong. Something's up. She's gone. It's late at night. She's usually in bed by now. I had had all these weird conversations with some friends of mine talking about God, and I didn't bring it up. Somebody else did. Mm-hmm. We never talked about God, never talked about Jesus. And that night, he was kind of the topic of discussion. And so one guy said, oh, he came from a flying saucer and, you know, whatever, all this stuff. It was just bizarre. And I'd you know, been really trying to keep it together. I by sheer force of will, all I did was smoke a little dope and drink a little beer for 2 weeks or something. I hardly did any dope at all, which was really big stuff for me. I'm trying to get my head clear. I start feeling like I'm on an acid trip or something just because of the conversation. I turn on the television. It's a Twilight Zone. Hmm. It's an episode about a guy sells his soul to the devil and he dies and ends up in hell kind of thing. I mean, that's mm-hmm. how it ends.
I saw that one.
Oh, it's freaky. I've seen it since, and it's almost as yeah. freaky now. Mm-hmm. Then the portals of prayer come on. And in those days in Milwaukee, the TV station would sign off, wouldn't be on all night. So this preacher's there. We used to drop acid, you know, and smoke our brains out and turn off the sound and watch these preachers, these priests or whoever, quoting scripture up there on the TV. And it'd be like Hendrix or Cheech and Chong comedy albums. We'd just laugh our heads off at these guys. This particular night, I don't know if he knows God or knew God or whatever in a real way, but I understood every word he said. The guy quoted a bunch of scripture. It all made sense. Mm. And what struck me as really weird was not that I wasn't laughing at him, but that he really made sense. Mm. It was like the lights are coming on, and I'm going, yeah. I think I understand that. That's kind of weird. I turn off the TV, and I crank on a Zeppelin album. I'm like, I got to stop thinking about all this. This is weird. And where's Mom? I look out the back kitchen window. Kitty Corner is my uncle's house, her favorite brother. There's a hearse parked in the driveway.
Oh, no.
He'd had a heart attack. He had several of them, and when I saw that, it's like, he's dead, you know, and that's why. She's gone. She's over there with my aunt freaking out, and man, I'm like death and God and, you know, what are you done with your life? And I'm just freaking out. I started crying, and I never cried. I started crying. I'm like, what is going on? And I remember the back door slamming, and I thought, it's the devil coming to collect, you know? I mean, it's like, I really did. I thought, I might as well just go out to meet him, you know? I deserve to go to hell anyway. I mean, what's the point? I mean, it was just such a wild night. I walk out there, and it's the paper. Sunday morning. I'm like, oh, cool, man. I'll read the comics. I got to stop thinking about all this stuff. Mm-hmm. About 3 in the morning, I pop the paper up on a table, and everything I read a few weeks ago in the New Testament is on the front page. Mm. Men's hearts failing them for fear. Mm. Heart Association says heart attack rate highest in recorded history in the U.S. Mm-hmm. The raging of the waves of the sea, about 33,000 people were wiped out from a monsoon, a hurricane that hit the coast of Thailand the day before. That was on the front page. You know? Peace, peace when there is no peace. Some hippie, and we're supposed to be loving people and talking about peace and love, started swinging at a cop downtown Milwaukee, mm-hmm. you know, and smacked mm-hmm. the guy a few times, and they had to arrest him.
So you're seeing all this stuff.
All of it on the front page of the paper. And I'm like going,
what's going on?
This right. is completely crazy. Mm-hmm. And the door slams again, and I'm like, now what? And mm-hmm. it's my mom, and she's like, Gene died, you know, your uncle. Mm-hmm. I'm so sorry, you know. I'm like, wow, she's freaked. She's like, I'm gonna go back with your Aunt Jill, and you know, I'll mm-hmm. spend a night with her, and you know, you'll be all right. I'm like, okay, you know. And so she left. That all happened in 10 minutes, and I'm standing there in the kitchen with my dog, and I'm like thinking about all this stuff. And I started just talking out loud to God. I'd like, you know, I'm so sorry for all the stuff I've done. I've wrecked so many people's lives, a small-time dope dealing. I mean, I, you know, girl to girl. I mean, I didn't care, love, or respect anybody. You know, I've wrecked my life. I've trashed my health. I'm like 18 almost here, and I'm just a mess. And I finally just said, you know, I'm so sorry about Gene. And then it hit me. He was my godfather. Mm. My godfather, you know, which is interesting. My godfather. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking about all this stuff, and I can't stop thinking about it. I turn on my mother's radio. She always had this thing on the most boring, stupid station. This guy's playing jazz records on Sunday morning on this really conservative radio. I'm like, did somebody bump the dial? What happened, you know? And in between these jazz records, he's saying, you know, God has a plan for your life. It's better than yours. You can know Jesus.
I'm like, what do you want?
What is going on? You know, right. I stood up, I turned the radio off, and I'm going, who are you? And what are you trying to say?
Wow.
Because I'm not getting it. I mean, I hear you, but I don't understand.
Wow.
For God so loved the world.
Isn't that something?
That yeah. he gave. God so loved you, me. I loved you so much, Glenn. Boom, you know, that scripture flashed through my mind. I hadn't thought of that scripture since I was six
years old. And see, his word never goes out void.
Never returns void. And yes. I'm like going, whoa. I broke down. I just broke down on the spot. I ended up on the floor. I remember that because Sam, because my black lab came up and started lapping my tears. I'm like just crying. Mm-mm. My eyes out going, why would you want me?
Wow.
Why would you love me? I've ignored you. I've lived a completely stupid, selfish life. I've wrecked all these people. I've wrecked myself. I've caused so much misery to my parents. And, you know, I'm the reason a stack of people in my school are absolutely slammed, trashed on dope now.
But you still love me.
Why would you love me? I mean, why? I wouldn't love me. Mm-hmm. And it was just no loud, you know, no angels walking in the room, vision of Jesus talking to me in an audible voice, just a very still, small voice in my mind and my heart, because I do, you know. Yes. Give me your life.
Wow.
And I mean, I'm like, you mean like turn it over? He's like, from day one, Barbara, and I'm not saying that I did it. It took me about 9 months to really absolutely let go, really let go. Some things were instant. Automatic, boom, delivered. Never, no more. I mean, just never again was this or that a temptation. Some things, smoking dope.
Sure.
music, idolatry with music. That was still so much of a security blanket for me at that point. Some of those things, and occasionally sexual issues, I had to really, really surrender to the Lord. Mm-hmm. And for me, that happened the day when I walked in the community that I'm now end up on the pastoral team of. But that night, it was January the 3rd, 71, I broke down and said, that's it. It's okay, well, you're getting ripped off. This is a one-sided deal. You give me eternal life and you get me. I get your life and you get my life.
Wow.
This is the worst one-sided rip-off deal I ever heard of. I mean, I wouldn't do that.
Yeah.
And it just blew me. I mean, I got it. I really got it. Mm-hmm. He wants my life. Mm-hmm. He doesn't want a prayer. He wants my life.
And what happened? What happened after that? Because I know that we have probably about like 15 minutes or so. And
I called my cousin up, who had been in a band with Misery Sons, on the other side of town. Now it's like 4 in the morning, and I'm like, Mike, I met God. Hmm. He's like, where are you? I said, I'm at home.
Are you on another acid trip?
Exactly. He goes, don't go anywhere. I'll be right over. He screams across town in his car, rips up the driveway, flies in the house and goes, sit down, eat chocolate. Here, where's the orange juice? You know, whatever. That's what, you know, hippies, we used to do that. You know, you eat a lot of chocolate. I don't know, whatever. It's supposed to bring you down. And I'm like, Mike, I haven't done any dope for a couple of weeks, really. I smoke a little, you know, whatever. He's like, are you nuts? He goes, look, you're not gay, I'm not gay, but get in bed. And he made me get in this double bed, you know, my mom's bed. He said, you go next to the wall, I'm going out here, you're not going anywhere. He just thought I'd lost my mind entirely. Mm-hmm. He really thought I just hammered myself into oblivion with dope. And I'm telling you that Jesus is real. We've been killing ourselves, man. It's the truth. It's all true, you know. And he's like, shut up and go to sleep, you know. And I'm like, I'm talking eternal life, Mike, this is the truth. Well, it took him a few years. He finally broke down and prayed too.
Mm-hmm.
But it was just the beginning,
right,
of such a change. I mean, friends of mine, I used to swear, I mean, every other word, just, you know, except when I was around mom, but otherwise it was like Pirate City. Hmm. I didn't even think about it.
Right.
A couple weeks later, a friend of mine in a band who's also become a Christian just called me the other day. And guy was a heroin addict for years, in and out of jail. He said, what's going on? Mm-hmm. I said, what? He goes, something's happening to you. You're not like, you know, something's happening.
That's
you're not like you
that's
were.
It. That's
and I'm
it.
Like, what do you mean? He goes,
yes.
Well, for one thing, you're not cussing every other word.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, wow, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
I hadn't noticed it.
So all these changes are taking place, and your music starts to change too?
Well, we got up at People's Park, alternate site in Milwaukee, and what was called that in those days, and built a stage up there, and there were, I don't know, 6-7 bands and 3,000-4,000 people out there, and we were the last band, you know, to get up and play, and it's a big deal. And I told Mike, I said, you know, I made a commitment to the Lord back in January. Here it is like September. And I said, I know you think I'm a crazy idiot and you're not going to understand, and that's cool. But I'm going to change a bunch of the lyrics today.
Wow.
And of course, I'd written some of the songs anyway, so whatever. And I just sang about Jesus.
Wow. And what you were known as, what band at that time?
That was Misery's Sons.
That was Misery's Sons. Wow.
So we're up there and all these burnouts with Bally High and, you know, Hash Forever. And, you know, we're up there just changing all these lyrics.
Start singing about Jesus.
Jeff Beck and Zeppelin songs. And, you know, we do Stairway to Heaven. It's like, I'm not kidding, you know, kind of thing. Whatever. It just, and the cops came and shut it down. And he's just like, wow, the moment of glory, you know, kind of a thing. And there was talk about record deal. And anyway, he pulls up at my house, you know, and up in the door. And I got out of this MG he had at the time. And I got out and I said, you know, I love you, buddy. I mean, you know I love you, and I quit.
Wow.
I got to quit.
Wow.
You know, I've been talking about following Jesus. I prayed with people to come to the Lord, and I've been in the Bible constantly, and I'm going to church constantly, and I'm still playing on the side, occasionally smoking dope here, and, you know, I'm done with this. Mm-hmm. It's over. It's over. And that was September of 71.
Okay.
And the 18th, actually, I literally gave all my equipment away to a Christian band. I moved in the community with a suitcase and a sleeping bag and a pillow.
Wow.
And that was the end of it. Period. Done. It's over.
My life is... So that idolatry that you talked about with music, that was it. That was the day that your Isaac went on the altar.
Absolutely. Wow. And it was very interesting because what happened after that is a couple of the pastors, after some time, had asked me, well, actually, they asked me, it's a weird moment. There were 5,000 people at a huge church convention in Milwaukee, rather. And they asked the Jesus people to show up, which we did, and share some testimonies. Well, a guy named Greg Nancaro, this brilliant acoustic musician, gets up. He's playing folk songs, two or three of them. One of the elders of the Jesus people in Milwaukee walked up to me and said, people have told me that you come from a musical background, that you know, blah, blah, blah. And I said, yeah. He said, when Greg's done it, would you go up and take his guitar and just sing a song?
Wow.
Well, I hadn't sung any songs for quite a while. The few I'd written about the Lord, I'd even stopped singing those. I mean, I didn't remember anything. I didn't know any mm-hmm. songs. We sang a few scripture choruses, you know, that sort of thing. And I'm like, he didn't mean that. Mm-hmm. And so I go up there, Greg smiles, puts the guitar on me. I turn around in front of 5,000 people and I start making up a song. Three verses and a chorus that repeated and all the words rhymed, and
wow.
I never sang it before in my life, you know.
Wow, that's amazing.
Finished it, handed him the guitar and sat down. I'm like,
where did that come from?
What's going on? There were a number of situations like that.
And when did Res Band start? Because that was that the first Christian band? I think they might roll in.
Well, one of the first full-blown rock bands, I guess. It was December 12th, 71.
Okay.
And at first it was a bit acoustic, and then I realized people were like talking over the band. We'd play in a coffee house or somewhere, or some outdoor concert, and people would be flirting with their girlfriend instead of listening. And I'm like, boy, it'd sure be nice. I mean, it's one thing if the gospel's rejected, but it can't even be rejected if it's not heard, you know.
Right, right.
Nobody's paying attention. So I'm like, what am we doing? I mean, I'm coming from Black Sabbath and Zeppelin.
Yeah, and I think they're actually showing a bit of it right
now. Oh, yeah,
now.
Yeah.
Back
me,
in the
me
day,
and Wendy in the old
yeah.
days.
Yeah. Like the hair.
We got crazy one night. Somebody said, how about an afro? I'm like, whatever. Block party on Union Street. We were down on the
wow.
south side, and I remember that because I remember some guy was drunk out of his skull, kept coming up by the microphone yelling for Black Eyed Peas and stuff. Union
so,
Street.
So you were in the coffee house. Nobody was really listening. So how did you make this transition then?
By cranking the amps up, by plugging in, and just.
And they let you do that without kicking you out or anything.
Yeah, well, a few people wondered what was going on at first, and. You know, there were always conservative churches that were, what they didn't realize is we were more conservative spiritually, doctrinally, even theologically than most of them, but culturally.
Right.
You know, wait a minute, there's 380 verses that speak about music in the Bible, clearly and contextually, 40 in the New Testament, 340 in the Old, and most of these folks don't have a clue what those verses say.
Mm-hmm.
They haven't spent any real time studying the scriptures, they just don't know. This is different, it's new, it's weird, it sounds worldly. You know, well, to me, three-piece suits are worldly. So, you know, driving a Beamer is a little suspect. I mean, what are you doing? So, you know what I'm saying? I mean, mm-hmm. I'm like, you know, we're a bunch of Jesus freaks who are serious about the Lord and are doing music that is actually the music that the kids are listening to.
Right, right.
And
right.
yeah, there were some folkies around in those days, you
sure.
know, Peter, Paul, and Mary, and Joan Baez mm-hmm. and stuff. But... I we'd see people in Christian coffee houses singing, really ministering incredible songs and speaking the truth in love, and great artists, great
mm-hmm,
performers.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to joints like blah blah blah.
Right.
Blah, blah, blah.
How long were you as a band when you were the Res Band? How long did that go?
Well, from then until I would suppose about 6 or maybe 7 years back.
Okay.
About 7 years ago, and folded on into Glenn Kaiser Band, which I was telling you earlier, we were trying to come up with a different name, and nobody could come up with a different name than lame names. And it's a band. It really is three of us. And anyway, the bass player, Roy Montroy, was a bass player in Rez Band. And the drummer in GKB was the sound tech. Really talented guy, incredible drummer, and incredible sound tech as well, with Rez Band for years. Okay. So we've been together forever. And,
okay. So you did the Rez Band thing for a while. You went on tours. You were touching
27, 8 years, something,
wow,
all over the world.
Wow. And I remember the Rez Band. I remember
tours.
It. Yeah.
A lot
and
of
I'm
Marshall,
younger than you, but I remember
a lot of Marshall, a lot of Marshall stacks, and
touching people's lives and just touching young people's
we
lives.
We still get email just about every day.
Wow.
People that are pastors that are on the mission field. One of the coolest things somebody wrote me a
and
while
so
back.
So here's the Glenn Kaiser Band.
Oh yeah, there's
now.
GKB. Okay, that's right. Roy. Yeah, and I play a lap steel as well, and it's fun. Slide guitar, different thing. Harmonica.
Great. Wow. What a difference. New hairdos too. It looks like.
Yeah. Well, mine's falling out. Yeah.
Yeah. It's so neat to see how long lasting.
Well, it's been interesting. We, I kind of reverted to blues rock, and that's really where I started. I mean, that's what I was playing and singing as a kid. So I've kind of gone full circle and back to my own roots, and I find myself always pioneering a little bit, always pushing the envelope a little bit. There's still only a handful of Christian blues players and singers, and that's a whole genre of music that is rather timeless.
Yes.
And you can do it when you're 60, 70, and 80.
Yes,
you know,
right.
Set up, prop up on a chair, and just honk away. Yeah. So, I've been able to do a number of acoustic and electric blues albums and solo stuff, and then we've done what, 4 GKB projects and.
Yeah, I'm sitting in front of me. I see this is your newest one called Bound for Glory, and also this one is Glenn Kaiser Band Live. Mm. And if you're watching and you want to know anything more about these, you can certainly contact us, give us a call, and we'll tell you how you can get a hold of these. Bound for Glory and Glenn Kaiser Band Live. And we're actually going to be having another show, and Glenn is going to actually sing on the program live. I think they may do a role on this show too, where you're doing some singing.
Okay.
So that's kind of
cool.
Oh, here it comes.
I feel what they feel and I understand. In the hunger and fear of my fellow man. Yeah. Love is what I need. Love is all I seek. It's something everyone can use. Love is
wow, that is awesome. What a phenomenal story that we heard today from Glenn Kaiser. And just in him sharing his testimony, you can see that doesn't matter what state you're in life, what things you've experienced, whether you've been abused, whether you've been involved in abuse, whether you've been involved in drugs or presently involved, God loves you so much. He loves you with an everlasting love, and He wants to touch you. And if He can take someone like Glenn, someone at a very young age who experienced probably a good word would be rejection, not really receiving love in his home, not growing up in a Christian environment, but just that God could reach him, then there's hope for you. And Glenn, what I'd like for you to do is, we have a couple minutes left. Would you just, there's actually literally like 2 minutes left. Could you say a word to the audience and then pray?
I'd be glad to, Barbara. Thanks for having me today. You know, a lot of people wonder, is God real? And the question is not, is God real, but are you real with God? He came. Jesus came and died on the cross for you and me. That's not words. That's not rhetoric. That's not preacher's rap. That's true. And the Father raised him from the grave so you could have a new life. Life, real life. The Bible says that I'm dead and my life is hidden with Christ in God. And when he appears, I'm going to appear with him. We have a family, and it's an eternal family. And the only way that you can really know that love and that hope and that peace and be a part of that family is by calling on his name. There's no other name given under heaven among people by which we must be saved but the name of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. It starts by saying, Lord Jesus, forgive me, change me. Here's my life, take me, do what you want with me. I trust that you did die for me, that the Father raised you from the grave. I surrender, I give it up. If that's your heart, if you're willing to face up to the fact that we're not God, but the real one really came, and he's here, and he's with you, even now where you are, in your situation, in your sin, he's trying to call to you. Would you hear him? Would you surrender? Jesus, forgive us. Mm-hmm. Forgive us for the selfishness, for the lust, for the covetousness, the greed, the arrogance, just the numbness that we sometimes feel towards you and others. And would you just take our lives? Would you do what you want with us? Would you make us the people that you brought us into the world to become? And would you help others to come to know you as a result of our lives? Thank you, Jesus, that you are real and risen, and that your life has so changed mine. Mm. Thank you that we're able to do this today on this show, and just thank you that your love really is an everlasting love.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, the name of my Lord, our Lord, and Savior. Amen.
Amen.